Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. My name is David Godwin, and I'm the director of the Southern Fire Exchange Program with the University of Florida. I'm hosting the webinar today from Tall Timbers Research Station north of Tallahassee. Today, I'm excited to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Jesse Kreye with Penn State University. Over the next hour, Jesse will discuss his work exploring the flammability characteristics of eastern U.S. leaf litter and vegetative fuels. If you're a prescribed fire practitioner or a wildfire manager, this presentation should be well worth your time. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today. Dr. Jesse Kreye is an assistant professor of fire and natural resources management at Penn State University. He started his career as a firefighter with the Department of Natural Resources in Minnesota and the U.S. Forest Service in California. Jesse also served as an aircraft firefighter aboard the USS Enterprise in the Navy. He received his bachelor's degree in forestry and master's degree in natural resources from Humboldt State University in California, and a Ph.D. in forest resources and conservation from the University of Florida. Go Gators. So welcome, Jesse. It's great to have you with us today. And just one moment, everybody, as we swap out our presentations.
Well, thank you, David, for that introduction. Very excited to be able to present some of our research with the Southern Fire Exchange. I've been up at Penn State now for a little over a year, but like David had said, I spent some time in the Southeast, and I still try to keep my foot down in Florida as much as I can, particularly in the winter time when that's possible. So I still try to do work at Tall Timbers and over at the Ordway Searcher Biological Reserve over by Gainesville. Anyway, what I'll be talking about today is kind of a rundown of quite a bit of research that myself and some other colleagues here, Morgan Varner, who's now back in the South at Tall Timbers, Jeffrey Kane, he's a professor at Humboldt State, Kevin Hires, who's there at Tall Timbers, and Eamon Engbar, who's a fire ecologist with the National Park Service in California. A lot of our work that we've looked at over the last 10 years or so and trying to better understand the nuances of litter flammability. And primarily a lot of this research we'll talk about was conducted in the South with various reasons for doing this that I'll get into. And so I'll kind of run through a fair amount of our kind of results. I'll have some data slides and stuff like that since I'll be going through quite a bit of stuff. But hopefully I can make it relevant for what it kind of all means to put it all together. Okay. So if we go back in our, kind of fire research history, of course, we've tried to categorize fuels in various ways to help us predict fire behavior. And so here, the classic work by Richard Rothermel, where he developed a fire spread equation that's primarily the equation that's still used in most fire prediction software that people are using today. When he had conducted this work, he essentially broke down fuels into about 11 different categories or fuel models that could be input into this fire spread equation. So not just putting, looking at fuel as all one component, but developing these fuel models that were actually linked with something that made sense, in the ecosystem context that you were working in. So there's grass fuel models or shrub fuel models or timber understory fuel models and then logging slash fuel models. And that made sense to categorize them in that way because he essentially came up with several parameters for each of these fuel models that were then input into his equation to predict fire spread. The idea is that across these different fuel models, there's various, fuel bed properties that influence fire behavior in different ways. And you can kind of see here kind of packing ratio on the bottom, which is something about density, and then reaction velocity, which is essentially kind of a fire intensity metric. And you kind of see how these different fuel models, if you will, fall out on these kind of different lines. Okay, so it certainly made sense to break down fuels in this manner. And about 10 years later, Hal Anderson kind of added to that and came up with our kind of, you know, 13 fuel models that most people are pretty aware of that we use in a lot of our prediction systems. And then later on, Scott and Bergen had expanded that to about 40 fuel models to start to kind of separate them out even more by the various nuances of their fuel bed characteristics for fire behavior predictions. We've kind of been looking, you know, categorizing fuels in different ways, but largely predict fire behavior, okay? And so one of the things we were interested in beyond that question is, do species themselves differ in flammability? And the work we'll be talking about today is focused all on, you know, litter flammability, so forest floor flammability, where a lot of our, you know, fire behavior occurs, a lot of prescribed fires, and, you know, we're obviously really interested in litter moisture as far as, you know, the probability of ignition and, you know, how well, for, you know, litter burns, not only as a surface fuel bed, but that, you know, that can provide the heat source to ignite shrubs and canopy fuels and things of that nature. So we were interested in really diving in and looking at, do species matter and is there variability among species in litter flammability? And so why would this matter? So of course, for fire prediction, you know, anything that we can find out more to understand the variability in fire behavior is going to help us in predicting fire behavior. So if species difference were important, you know, that could maybe help be incorporated into some fire behavior predictions. But kind of one of the drivers for us was really kind of this ecological context. Okay, so thinking about, you know, is there an ecological role of flammability and what does that mean in relation to the species that we're talking about and how species might exist within fire-prone landscapes that they exist in, or species that don't necessarily occur in fire-prone landscapes. And so that kind of was a driving force for a lot of this research. And with that, we could think about, you know, managing fire behavior itself. Okay, so fire not only impacts vegetation, but vegetation is the fuel that burns. And so vegetation impacts the kind of fire behavior and fire effects that we get. And of course, there's this kind of feedback, since fire and vegetation feedbacks. And if species matters, you know, manipulating composition, you know, can change the kind of fire behavior that you would get on the ground during prescribed burning. So, and with that, kind of thinking about, you know, what that means in terms of restoring fire-dependent ecosystems where fire's been excluded for long durations and where species composition has been drastically changed over those decades of fire exclusion. So there's kind of some of the reasons to look at some of this stuff. So kind of early on, about 2008, Jeff Kane and myself were graduate students when Morgan Varner was teaching at Humboldt State. And Jeff got interested in this question of variability of flammability of different oak species in the Southeast. And so one of the drivers for this was thinking about how different oaks fit within these fire-prone longleaf pine ecosystems, okay? And so what he did was looked at the flammability of litter across 8 different oak species in the South. And the interesting thing about the South that you all know that are down there, that folks up here who aren't familiar with oaks in the South find kind of fascinating, is that there's a wide variability in oaks and oak litter. Obviously you have live oaks down there. You have oaks that, you know, persist in dry uplands, you know, and even, you know, dry longleaf pine savannas such as Turkey oak that can persist in those landscapes, and others that are, you know, exist primarily down in, you know, more wetter areas, but also don't do well in more fire prone environments. So he looked across these 4 species or these 8 species to kind of understand how they fit in the context of frequent fire regimes in the Southeast. And so what he found certainly was evidence for different flammability across these 8 species, but it's interesting how they kind of clustered out. And so essentially what the data are here is, you know, we conduct some flammability experiments and measure, you know, a few different flammability metrics. You kind of pool those together and you end up with something like this, where across the different species, you can see visually how they cluster together in terms of their similarity in flammability. Now, let me see if I can turn on one of these annotation tools. Let's see here, a spotlight. If you can see, I kind of got a little laser pen here in case I need it. But essentially what he found out is there was, you know, two clusters. Okay, and so in this graphic, we essentially have this blue cluster here, which is primarily composed of laurel oak, water oak, live oak, and bluejack oak. And these were the species that didn't burn very well. Whereas in this cluster down here, this yellow cluster, it's primarily turkey oak, southern red oak, post oak, and sand post oak. And these guys were pretty flammable. And so what Jeff did is he called these, this group up here, he called fire impeders, okay, that they dampen flammability. And the others he called fire facilitators. Okay, so thinking about it in the context of these species on the bottom that, you know, we often know can persist in fire-prone landscapes also have pretty flammable litter. And the idea here is that they're helping to facilitate fire in a fire-prone environment in which they're existing. Where these fire impeders up here, you know, if you work in the south, if you do a lot of burning in the south, you often know that if you have laurel oak that's moved into some uplands that have been fire excluded for some time, it's often difficult to get that litter to burn. Okay, so kind of the idea is that these guys are potentially coming in and dampening fire behavior and making it more difficult for fire to burn in these fire-prone landscapes. So that's pretty interesting. Let me see here if I can figure out a... Hold on 1 second. When I went to the spotlight, now I don't know how to advance.
Is the arrows on your keyboard do it?
Yeah, they're not doing that.
Oh, go back up and see if you can exit out of the spotlight or pointer.
Bingo.
All right.
Thanks, cool. David. Appreciate that. Somehow I got an arrow with my name on it. There we go. Okay, that's gone. All right. Okay, so after that, Eamon Angbar, who's now fire ecologist, National Park Service in California, he was working with Morgan and Well, and he wanted to look at flammability across oak species in California. And even if you're unfamiliar with these, there's a lot of oak species in California. It's pretty diverse. And essentially what he found is kind of a similar thing, that they cluster out, you know, some oak litter is not very flammable, some are kind of intermediate, and some are very flammable. And they have some, you know, ecological context that makes sense in that respect. But the other interesting thing that he found, he started to look at measuring leaf characteristics and how they correlated with flammability. And he found some pretty tight relationships with a few leaf characteristics that basically showed that large leaves that are lobed and curl a lot are more flammable. Folks that burn a lot in leaf litter and hardwood leaf litter, you know, often kind of see that the really fluffy leaves can burn very well. So he was putting some interesting numbers to how these individual leaves are actually controlling fire behavior, flammability. So that's pretty interesting across still thinking about just oak species, which is fascinating. So I followed up with this because I was thinking about a couple things. We were thinking about this mesovacation issue that I'll talk about in a bit. But obviously, fuel moisture is a critical aspect to fire behavior. Okay, beyond the fact that both Jeff and Eamon were showing that species litter burn differently, all else equal, because all of those were of equally dry and different, didn't differ in their moisture contents. Their dynamics and how litter dries is obviously going to be an additional impact that it would have on flammability, right? And so what I started to do is I looked at a suite of 17 species in the Southeast, not just oaks, but several others, and tried to look at variability in essentially their drying response. So how much moisture do they soak up, and how quickly do they dry, okay? And in this mess of a whole bunch of graphs, you see a lot of nice looking correlations. And essentially we have time lag on the y-axis for all of these. Okay, so those of you who are familiar with time lag, the larger the time lag, like in a time lag fuel, the slower it is to dry. Okay, so that's essentially a metric here. We showed that several leaf characteristics were also correlated with how well leaf litter dried, okay? And so essentially we kind of found the same thing that Eamon had found with flammability. Large curly leaves that are very sinuous, have a lot of lobing and curls, you know, a lot, they dry quickly, okay? So not only do they, are they more flammable, all else equal, but they're also shedding water more readily. So essentially they're gonna become more available for combustion too. So kind of an, you know, an additive or even a multiplicable effect on flammability. That's pretty interesting. And so when I actually clustered these out by species, we found, this was kind of the more fascinating stuff. And this is kind of what was, we were really interested in looking at is, okay, well, what's the pattern? How do these species cluster out in their moisture dynamics? Okay. And we see that there was clearly some clusters that came out. And so in this graph on the right, the lower left part of the graph is essentially low moisture retention, okay? So on the x-axis, it's how much water these fuel beds soaked up when we soaked up the fuel beds in water and then took them out. And then the y-axis is that drying response time or time lag again, okay? So lower left, they're drying really readily. On the upper right, they have high moisture retention, okay? So they're soaking up a lot of moisture and they're very slow to dry, okay? And so we see that species cluster out in pretty interesting ways for us. So if we look at these two on the lower left, okay, most of the oaks fit in here. You know, the pines fit in the southern, in the one on the south or on the bottom left. And I don't have them written out with their common names, but in that very lower left-hand, let me get this annotation back. Okay, let me see here, spotlight. All right, so this lower left-hand cluster here, we can see longleaf pine, okay, white oak, loblolly pine, turkey oak, southern red oak. Okay, these are the guys that are not taking up much moisture at all and they're drying really, really rapidly, okay? And so we think about those species, or you're familiar with those species, these are all species that are not only, are also flammable, but they also persist in these fire-prone environments. Okay, this next cluster up here, we find those oaks that Jeff had looked at that he called fire and peaters. Okay, we see, well, we have live oak there, we see water oak, we see laurel oak, as well as magnolia. And so these guys, they're taking up not a whole lot of moisture, but they're drying a lot slower, okay? So it's interesting to us in thinking about the context of these species that we might consider moving into fire-prone environments when we exclude fire. Not only are they less flammable, all else equal, but they're also slower to dry. So they're kind of retaining moisture in that sense, okay? If you look over in this cluster here, there's kind of a mix. So we have beech, and then we have tulip poplar, okay? They're essentially soaking up a lot more moisture as a fuel bed, okay? And then in the upper right here, we have kind of the freak of all, and that's red maple, okay, Acer rubrum. So red maple, out of all of these species, soaked up the most moisture, and it soaked up a lot and was very slow to dry out, okay? And so red maple is important to us because a driver of this work was really this idea of mesification. And so if you're unfamiliar with the term mesification, this is something that was coined by Greg Nowacki and Mark Abrams, who are actually up here in Penn State. And the idea of mesification is this thought that over decades of fire suppression, that there are significant changes to not only the overstory canopy structure, but also the litter that may have significant impacts in reducing potential fire behavior. So if we look at this kind of figure here, we have pre-1900, the assumption is fire was a part of this landscape. It's an open structure, it's pine and probably oak, maybe have some herbaceous fuels here. After suppressing fire over time, the canopy starts to close up. You start to get what they termed these mesophytic species, and red maple was one of the big culprits that's talked about a lot up here. These fire-sensitive species that are shade-tolerant, that come into these systems when they're not burned and essentially change the environment by closing the canopy and creating a forest floor that's much less flammable. Okay, it's cooler, it's more damp. And another thing that they had speculated besides that, is they had speculated that the litter itself might actually dampen fire behavior because their thoughts of just how some of these species litter lay flat, and they kind of anecdotally observe that they retain moisture. So this kind of concept is what drove that previous work. Okay, and so when we go back and look at this work here, this was all driven by this mesification. Essentially what we're finding is that the species that we would consider mesophytes are retaining more moisture and they're also less flammable. So the whole idea that there's species variability and flammability has some relevant ecological context. And thinking about the idea of restoration and trying to restore these sites that have had a lot of fire-sensitive species that have come in and encroached, there's a lot of challenges in many parts of the eastern U.S. to try and get fire back into these, you know, mostly historically oak and oak hickory and some pine ecosystems that have been essentially invaded, if you will, by these fire-sensitive mesophytes that are making it really challenging to get the kind of fire behavior back into the system for restoration. And, you know, there's significant concerns because there's a lack of oak regeneration in many of these sites because of the shaded environment, and it can be a challenge to get fire back into these sites. And once species such as red maple get in, they're often sprouting under these lower moderate intensity fires and still are a challenge. So anyhow, it's putting that this kind of species variability and flammability into more relevant context from a management perspective. So this mesification idea, we find evidence of this when we look at it in the field as well. So here's an example of an oak hickory restoration site in North Mississippi. It's at the Strawberry Plains Audubon Center up by Holly Springs. So Steve Brewer's at Ole Miss, University of Mississippi, for, gosh, I think it's upward well over 10 years now. He's been working in some of these sites that had a lot of, you know, what we would consider mesophytic species that had come into these oak hickory sites. And he'd been girdling them to essentially thin out the non-oaks. So he went into these sites and girdled all the non-oaks and then started to put fire on the ground every 2 years, and we're watching it over time. So one of the things we came in to look at is it gave us an opportunity to look at these sites that he had essentially restored and removed the mesophytes. He removed the input of mesophyte litter into these systems, and then we have adjacent controls that we could look at. And so here's an example of some of the data when we were tracking litter moisture, both at the base of trees, so that's the basal on the left, and then out in the open beyond their drip lines on the right. And this was sampling done over, just an example of sampling over 1 day. So we sampled every 3 hours from morning through the night. Okay, in both of these, you know, scenarios, you can see that the arrows are pointing to the bottom darkened triangles. These are the sites that Steve had thinned and had removed the non-oaks. Okay, so essentially we're showing that litter moisture was drier, you know, certainly throughout the day, and that even held true into the night under the darkened conditions. And one thing interesting about these data here is you can see this was a This was taken in December. So December 13th and the deciduous forest. So kind of the two big components of the whole mesification thing is that, you know, the closed canopy causes shading of the forest floor, and that potentially has obvious impacts on moisture dynamics, flammability, but also the litter composition. We've essentially taken away the shading impact in these particular data because it was done in December where all the leaves are off of the trees. So maybe a little more evidence that the litter composition itself is causing a drier environment in these sites where it's back to just being oak and some hickory. Excuse me. And so we followed up from that work by doing some laboratory experiments to try and see, you know, how does it look if we actually start mixing litter together, okay? And looking at moisture dynamics as well as flammability. Okay, so this work here, you can see we had essentially four different treatments, if you will, of fuel beds, where we incorporated a percentage of these mesophytic species into oak and oak hickory. So here, the mesophytes were sweet gum, wing elm, and dogwood. And we selected those because those were the dominant mesophytes in this site in North Mississippi. And so we simply just incorporated them in with oak leaves as a proportion, and then soaked them up and dried them down, and then burned them under these different drying times to see how not only incorporating litter, but this may be somewhat reflective of, okay, if composition is at a certain stage, you know, what's the impact that these mesophytes may have on flammability? Is there kind of a threshold? We see here in these data that starting off on the left, SMC is saturated moisture content. So we soak these fuel beds up to saturated moisture content. And you can see right off the bat, before even drying them, the fuel beds that were composed of, you know, over 50% mesophyte litter were wetter than those fuel beds that either had no mesophytic litter or only, you know, a third of it. So we see kind of a separation already. And you can see what we did was we dried those fuel beds for 12 hours and then 24 hours and then allowed them to get to EMC, there is equilibrium moisture content. So we allowed them to all dry in the lab. And at that point at EMC, all of the litter beds are essentially the same moisture content, around 7%. Okay. So you can see these differences, they hold true after 12 hours, they hold true as well at 24 hours, you know, the more mesophytic fuel beds are still wetter and then they all become dry. And you kind of see that it's not that they're equally separated, okay? So you see that there may be some threshold in the middle that if there's a little bit of mesophytic litter in there, maybe it's not gonna make that much of a difference. But if you have two thirds, you know, you're starting to have a substantial impact on moisture dynamics. And then when we burn these, we can see how that's reflected in their flammability. So in this graph, you know, on the y-axis, we have flammability. So, you know, higher up is more flammable. And then on the x-axis, we have that, you know, mesophyte proportion again. And then we have the different drying times. Okay, so at the bottom, those open circles, that's when we burned all these fuel beds after 12 hours of drying, okay? And you can see by increasing mesophytic litter into these oak fuel beds, it's substantially dampening fire behavior, okay? We see that as well after 24 hours, okay? But obviously after 24 hours, it's a little bit drier, okay? But in both of those scenarios, it's kind of the combined effect that the litter has both on, you know, how it's retaining moisture, and possibly, you know, their flammability themselves, if that makes sense. To clarify that, if you look at the data from where it says EMC on the top, the darkened circles, so keep in mind across all of those different fuel beds going from left where it's all oak litter to the right where it's all the mesophyte litter, you still see a dampening effect on flammability of increasing the proportion of these mesophytes, even though they're all the same moisture content, they're fairly dry, okay? So it clearly shows a pretty substantial impact that species is having on flammability and what that means for restoring these fire-dependent oak ecosystems. Okay. So another component of the mesification work, and this has implications beyond that. So several reasons why we wanted to start looking at this. But if we think about it in this kind of mesification context, you know, one of the thoughts is that shading, you know, is going to influence moisture dynamics and is going to influence flammability. And so for that reason and some other reasons, because we don't fully understand, we haven't really fully quantified the impact that the sun has on leaf litter flammability, we wanted to start looking at the role that it actually does play. So we did some work down at Tall Timbers by creating, in this work here, we created fuel beds essentially of longleaf pine and then oak litter, and then basically shaded some of this and then tracked their fuel temperature and their moisture content over time to try and really kind of get a sense at what role is the sun playing, and then in concert to that, you know, if there's this idea of mesification and shading these environments, you know, in concert, what's the shading impact actually have on litter flammability? So here you look, there's an infrared image on the right, you're looking from up above. We essentially have a large fuel bed of longleaf pine needles, and then there's these little piles of oak leaves set up within that, and then the darkened areas are essentially we had shade covers over those areas, and then we tracked the litter over time from the morning until early afternoon. And so here, this is really interesting. So this is, we have fuel temperature. Okay, so this is the temperature of the surface of the litter from our IR images over time. And so if we look at, let me see if I can get annotation back. Okay. On the left, we see in the morning, we essentially have the darkened circles here are the shaded litter. Okay. And the open circles are, you know, litter that was obviously exposed to the sun. Okay. So early in the morning, there's not a whole lot of difference. Okay. But, you know, when we looked at them later on, we start to see some substantial differences in the, shaded litter versus the litter that was exposed to the sun, okay? As much as 113 degrees Fahrenheit, okay? So at 11 o'clock, the shaded litter is essentially about 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and the stuff in the sun is at about 113 degrees Fahrenheit. So there's substantial impact that it has on surface fuel temperature. And of interest, we see differences between pine and oaks. So these up here are the oaks, the oak litter, okay, the squares, and pine litter here. We see that the oaks are reacting even more. If you think about an oak leaf, it's a little more, you know, almost like a solar panel when it's laying flat on the ground. It's really taking up a lot of heat, okay? So that fuel temperature matters because, let me get rid of my annotation. Not only just because the litter is hotter, but it has implications for looking at moisture content. Excuse me. So when we looked at moisture content over those same time frames, you can see clearly, let me get back to my pointer here, some interesting differences. So remember in the morning, fuel temperatures were pretty similar. Okay, but here we see major differences between the oaks. These are the oaks, okay? Shaded, not shaded. And then we have the pine down here. I think I have these. Yeah, okay. So we have our oaks and our pines. So early in the morning, look how much wetter the oak leaves are versus the pine needles, which is pretty interesting. Okay, the oak leaves are holding on to a lot of dew. You're looking at well over 100% moisture content, where pine's sitting around 50% moisture content in the morning. You can see over time, the oak leaves are reacting very readily to the solar exposure in terms of drying. So you can see that the open squares are drying more readily than the closed squares, showing the impact that it has on leaf drying. And if you look at the very end at 1300, you can see that the unshaded oak that started off pretty high is now the driest of all the fuels, highlighting that the impact that the sun has on moisture content. And we know this, you know, intuitively, right? You know, the sun shines, it's going to dry the fuels out more. But the thing that we've been thinking about is the importance of the boundary layer condition just above the litter and the impact that that has on drying. Because, and this is where it's really important in the Southeast where it's humid, if the sun is shining on litter and increasing the fuel temperature that much, just by the nature of the relationship between temperature and humidity, the humidity adjacent to that, you know, surface of the leaf litter is going to be a lot lower than, you know, even up at head height. Okay, so that boundary layer is going to be really important because the vapor pressure deficit then is going to be greater and it's going to more rapidly draw moisture out of the litter. And so I think what we're showing is something I think intuitively, you know, most managers and folks at Burn understand, but really showing how substantial sun's heating can have on moisture dynamics. And we wanted to follow up to see, well, what's the actual impact that the sun can have on flammability. So we did some recent work where we simulated the sun by using IR heat lamps in the lab and comparing those burns to burns that essentially didn't have heat lamps, okay, that were shaded, okay? And so what we have going on here, let me get back to my annotation laser. Okay. What we have here is we have, again, flammabilities on the y-axis, okay? More flammable as you go up, okay? And so we soaked these fuel beds up and dried them out. And then over time, okay, so this is drying time. So they're starting out the wettest and they're drying over time, okay? And then we burn them at various times, you know, along that drying path, if you will, okay? And what we have here is the darkened circles are actually the litter beds that we had the heat lamps on, okay? So when we were drying the litter, we actually had them exposed to these heat lamps, okay? So it's simulating the sun drying out the litter. Whereas those that don't have the heat lamps, it's simulating drying throughout the day, you know, in a shaded environment or a clouded environment, if you will. You could look at it that way too, okay? And so what allowed us to do is kind of look at these relationships. And let me turn this off. And it clearly showed us that the litter that was, you know, drying out under these IR heat lamps are becoming very flammable, you know, right away as they're drying, okay? Which makes sense. And we put the IR lamps, we kept the IR lamps on the litter beds when we burned them as well, okay? And this might be a way of kind of explaining this graphic if it's a little bit confusing. If we look at this upper portion, okay, this is the very top of the flammability axis, right? So this is when the litter is the most flammable, okay? So the litter that's exposed to the sun becomes very flammable, you know, within just a few hours, okay? We're talking up to 4 hours of drying time. If we're looking at this in the context of what's the effect of shading, okay? The shading in these fuels, the open circles, okay, and you can see the differences. We have some different loading here, but essentially it takes several more hours during the day of drying before that litter becomes as flammable as litter that's exposed to the sun. Okay, so it's giving us a little more nuanced information about how the sun is actually impacting flammability, okay? And so, you know, thinking about this from all of this stuff from kind of a management standpoint, you know, we have some pretty coarse tools that do, you know, incorporate shade versus sun, right? So, okay, what, you know, used to be the old Appendix B in the handbook when they used to still print it out, you know, when you would go through that, you just, you know, essentially have temperature and relative humidity, which would be taken, you know, up more up at like head height, certainly not looking at the boundary layer of the litter, but it did incorporate, you know, some sun and shade very coarsely in trying to get at and predict the probability of ignition, okay? And so this has given us some even more information of how strongly the sun can actually influence probability of ignition. And think about the context of how that influences flammability throughout the day. But all of our work showing that it matters because species flammability differs, it's going to matter what species composition you have. Okay, so folks that burn in a lot of oak and burn in a lot of areas where there's non-oaks, you know, see that oak litter, at least, you know, compared to other hardwoods, can be pretty flammable. Okay, but keeping that in mind in the context of if you're using, you know, coarse prediction of probability of ignition, knowing the species that are there can be important. I'll give you an example. The first fire I was on when I got up here to Penn State, I went out with the Game Commission on about a 700-acre burn, and it was all in oak hardwoods. And, you know, we were just kind of discussing, you know, if you looked in the handbook, your probability ignition was about 30%, you know, even at, you know, the, you know, peak time of the day, early to mid-afternoon when it was hottest and drying and driest, you know, it wasn't that bad. But the entire day was fighting spot fires all along both sides of the line, okay? And I was just sitting and watching. I was just there observing, just watching oak litter, you know, burn and then go up in the air, drop over the line, and, you know, most of them were starting spots, okay? And so thinking about, you know, the nuances of how the species matter, and this site had, you know, been fairly opened up by some gypsy moth damage. So, you know, some of those, you know, the species and how they react from a moisture standpoint and a flammability standpoint, it looked like, you know, was igniting in a way that was, you know, not predicted very well in just using the coarse probability of ignition. So that's kind of an example how that fits within a management context. And I think the important thing to consider is that eastern fuels are complex. And what I mean by that is, you know, a lot of this work, you know, especially thinking about the solar impact on moisture dynamics and the role that species plays in both moisture dynamics and flammability. Compared to the West, you know, we don't have long, you know, dry periods seasonally like you have out West, okay? So some of these issues may not matter so much in California in August or September. Okay, so the nuances, let's say species differences in moisture dynamics, probably doesn't matter because everything's going to be single digit moisture contents. It's really dry. If you go, you know, months without rain, those things aren't necessarily as important. Everything's going to be dry. But out east, we, you know, don't have those long dry periods. And so these, you know, these finer scale nuances and impacts that either species have or that the sun can have. If you think about, you know, if you know in like a savanna or even a little more open woodland, like the structure of the canopy, it's gonna impact sun flex on the forest floor and how that might impact litter moisture or litter flammability. Those little, you know, fine scale things can matter in time out here in an environment that tends to be generally wet and tends to be in the southeast, really humid, okay? If it's 85% humidity, but the sun's baking the litter, and the litter's 120 degrees, and it's actually really dry at the surface of that litter can be a lot drier than what some might otherwise think, okay? And I think about kind of the context of how we look at moisture of extinction being higher in the southeast and what, you know, kind of role that this might play in. I think this is a really important concept in the East where we have a lot more humidity and we have a lot, you know, we don't, especially up here, the further north we get, you know, we have narrower burn windows. Okay. We certainly don't get the amount of burn days that you do down in Florida, but those little things can really matter of trying to capitalize on days that you can burn or the timing that you can burn. Okay. Okay, so kind of one last thing that I wanted to look at is we've looked at all this, you know, we looked at flammability across different species and it's kind of, you know, answered some of the questions we were interested in. You know, I really get interested in the ecological role that flammability has. And so we wanted to look at, you know, are fire protection traits correlated with flammability? Okay. So, you know, what's really kind of driving this is how do these, you know, species fit within the fire regimes in which they occur? Okay. So we know that many species, like, you know, turkey oak, for example, that persist in a really flammable environment, like a longleaf pine savanna, has certain traits that helps them to be able to survive that frequent fire regime, right? Okay, so putting on thick bark is kind of the easiest, right? If you allocate to bark accumulation, particularly early on, okay, and Tim Shearman, who I've been working with, has been doing some of this work, looking at not just bark thickness in general for a species, but when does it allocate it? And if it allocates it on early, like turkey oak puts on a lot of bark when it's really young, obviously that can, you know, give you some advantage by, you know, lowering the probability of mortality during these frequent fires, okay? But it comes at a cost, right? It's a carbon cost to put on bark. So you're gonna trade that in some other traits like height growth and things of that nature, okay? Bark wounding response, okay? So if you can close off a wound quickly, okay? So if you have some cambial damage from a fire, if you can close that wound off and limit subsequent, you know, rotting diseases or stuff from getting in there, that's gonna be an added trait that can help protect you in a fire-prone environment, okay? So we were interested in looking at, well, how do some of these fire protection traits correlate with flammability to help us maybe think about, you know, is flammability potentially a trait, if you want to use that word, that's associated with these fire-dependent species. And so we took a lot of our data from our moisture dynamics and our flammability data and looked at it with a bunch of other traits from work from the literature, from stuff that other folks have done. Okay, we found, you know, pretty interesting results. And just looking at it, essentially kind of almost a meta-analysis, if you will, because we're using other literature. But you can see kind of here in the upper left, you know, we have CO2 assimilation rates. It's something about its shade tolerance is related to essentially bark thickness, okay? And so species that are less shade tolerant are essentially putting on thicker bark, okay? We think about a lot of our fire-dependent species that rely on open canopy to be able to regenerate because they lack shade tolerance, such as a lot of pines and oaks, okay, there's some correlation with bark thickness, okay? And we see bark thickness is, you know, related positively with flame height, okay? So if you're allocating, you know, thick bark, you also happen to be, you know, putting on leaves that are more flammable as litter. Okay, canopy duration is related to flame height. That's kind of an interesting one. Okay, and that has a negative relationship. Essentially, if you think about on the left, if you look on the left figure, that D, okay, those of you that work in longleaf pine, I recognize that there's an oak dome sitting in the middle of that. Okay, I think I took this picture down in the Ocala National Forest. Okay, so you have a very fire-prone longleaf pine environment, and you have this sand live oak dome sitting in the middle of it, okay? And when we do all of our flammability work and our moisture work, sand live oak retains moisture and it's not very flammable, okay? So it's essentially like a fire shadow, but it's also hanging on to its leaves for a long duration, okay? So it's creating this shaded environment and casting litter that's not very flammable, okay? Essentially, it's creating its own little fire shadow so that when fires burn through these longleaf pines, it just kind of peels around these oak domes. And any of you that have burned in these systems, you know, see that a lot. Unless it's really, really dry and you have a lot of intensity, it tends to just kind of skirt around these oak domes and move around that, okay? We see seedling relative growth rate is negatively correlated with flame height as well. And, that, you know, an interest there is like, you know, some of the other traits like bark accumulation, if you're gonna accumulate a lot of bark early on, there's gonna be a trade-off. And you're gonna tend to trade that off in height growth, okay? But if you're growing in the open and in a site that's typically burned a lot, you don't necessarily need to grow that high, at least in terms of trying to give above your neighbor to try and capture the sunlight, if that makes some sense. So anyhow, when we pool all of these characteristics together, our flammability characteristics, our moisture dynamics, and all these other fire protection traits, we see even a clear clustering. Okay, if you know these oak species, okay, if we're just going to look at these six oaks, you know, we see live oak and sand live oak as, you know, clustered together, and we can kind of call those as avoiders. Okay, they're in an environment, they're avoiding fire. Okay, water oak and laurel oak, we can consider those mesophytes. Okay, they can, you know, invade some of these fire prone environments, but they're dampening fire behavior. And then on the bottom now we have, you know, we call our pyrophytes, okay? Blue jack, sand post oak, southern red oak, and turkey oak. And we know, you know, these guys all seem to persist in these fire-prone environments. So ecologically, this makes sense. And I think something that's interesting to me is, and you may not remember, but in all of our other work, blue jack oak, Quercus incana, was always one that from a litter standpoint, retains moisture, it's not very flammable, okay? But in this clustering, when we put all of its other protective traits in, all of a sudden it fits in with the pyrophytes. And that makes sense to those of you that know that blue jack, although it's uncommon, it can often, it persists in a lot of these fire-prone environments. It may not be really shedding a lot of flammable litter, but it's very protective and can persist. Pardon me. So with that, we kind of say that species that can persist in fire-prone environments are shedding flammable litter. That's kind of the big thing for me, okay? Pyrophytes not only love fire, and that's what pyrophytes means, but they're helping to create it, okay? So that's really interesting. So it has a lot of ecological context to it. Species that cannot persist in fire-prone environments happen to be also putting down litter that dampens flammability, okay? So that's... really interesting to us. And I guess that's all I have. That's my last slide. I'll turn it over to you, David, and I hope you have some time for some questions and discussion.
All right, well, thanks, Jesse. Once again, if you all join us during the presentation, my name is David Godwin, and I'm the director of the Southern Fire Exchange for the University of Florida. And that was Dr. Jesse Kreye from Penn State University. We do have time to take questions from everybody in the audience today. If you'll use the Q&A tool in Zoom to go ahead and type in your questions for Jesse, we'll try and get through them. Let me go ahead and pull that up now. And if you can't get the Q&A tool to work, you can certainly go ahead and type it into the chat window. Jesse, while we wait and see if we have some questions that come in, I was curious, have you guys started to do any work looking at the age of litter and whether or not litter age has a role in any of these moisture dynamics?
Right. So we have, so that's kind of our next stage, and I'm starting to do that up here. Mm-hmm. So we've started to collect a whole suite of litter across most of the species, you know, mid-Atlantic and the Northeast, and have been starting to burn them. And it's from an age perspective, we're going to try and compare litter collected in the spring to litter collected in the fall. Okay, very simple. But the whole idea, of course, is, and there's been a lot of discussion about this, is different species decompose at different rates, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's going to also have a potential impact. And so we're starting to look at that, but we haven't actually done any experiments with that of yet. And kind of the idea is what we would expect is like species like red maple, tend to anecdotally, you know, decompose faster. Okay. And so not only is it going to be more degraded and flatter, but you know, the other context to this is that, you know, there's maybe just less fuel overall because it's decomposing, whereas oak litter is going to hang around longer and essentially be there for a longer time and susceptible to be able to carry fire. Mm-hmm. Is that answer your question?
Yeah. Yep. We had a question or comment, I guess, came in, and somebody asked if you could, yep, flip back to that previous slide. So
okay,
there you go. If I was curious, another one of my notes here, so far it looks like your line of work has been all about drying rates and looking at separations of drying rates. between the different species. I've seen one recent publication actually came out of some work at the Austin Cary, and I don't know if you were on that project as well, where they were looking at wetting and differences between saw palmetto and longleaf pine needle cast in relation to rainfall events. Do you have any interest, or do you know if there's literature on kind of the flip side, not just the drying side, but the wetting of different species following rain events?
Yeah, I don't think that much. And I think I've seen that work too. But the stuff that I had on here, maybe I can flip back so it wasn't clear. So that was one of the things that we looked at, if that makes sense. Let me go back here. So if you can see on this figure on the right, do you see drying response on the y-axis?
Yeah.
On the bottom, that initial moisture content is how much water those litter beds soaked up. Mm-hmm. So is that essentially what you're getting at? So that would kind of be the wetting response, how much it wets, but not in the field. So this is just in the lab. And so just the species of themselves, like if you look at red maple in upper right, regardless of its drying response, it's soaked up more water as a percentage of its dry weight than any other species. Mm-hmm. So if you think about it from a wetting standpoint, it's becoming much more wet than the other species. And then subsequently, it's really slow to dry too. So there's just going to be, if you think about the windows of opportunity for ignition across these species, it's really going to vary during the day when these species, or what weather context that you might actually get flammability. And with red maple, it's just going to be really hard to get, weather conditions where it's dry enough to burn. And especially when you're not really thinking about the species, but you're really worried about, hey, it's going to be a really dry day today. We really shouldn't burn. Mm-hmm. Where maybe in an oak dominated site, it may be a risk and maybe you don't want to go in there and burn. But if you have a unit that's heavily red maple and you want to try and go in there and get some fire on the ground, those really dry days might be an opportunity where all of a sudden that unit pops up and goes, okay, let's go ahead and burn in this site to see if we can knock back the red maple, because there's less, probably less risk of something, going bad in that sense, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm.
Here's a question that came in from Scott, and Scott says, some might not classify Southern Red Oak as an actual facilitator of fire. So it was interesting to see that early in the day, it has high moisture compared to longleaf pine, but that by 11 a.m., they converged in moisture content. Is classification as a facilitator just dependent on the time of day that burn occurs?
So I think that's a really interesting question. We've had discussions with people that would, say like turkey oak, for example. Mm-hmm. Turkey oak just doesn't burn, and and this is someone else saying this, right? So in my experience, turkey oak just doesn't burn very well. And others will say, yeah, I've burned in turkey oak and it's gotten really hot and intense. And it may really depend on when you're burning it. Okay. So just from that data with Southern red oak, if you're looking at, in the morning, you're out doing your test fire, it might be very different, than what fire behavior is going to be like in the early afternoon at 1 o'clock. And if we think about it, like from an ecological standpoint, historically, if in fact these species are somehow adapted to do this, so what kind of idea is like flammability really something that they've developed, or even if it's not developed, but as happenstance allows them to persist, when would a typical wildfire occur, in the morning, when you tend to be doing your test fire? Probably not. Probably in the afternoon when lightning is starting to come and fuels are drier. So I think that time of day really is an important component in thinking about the context of how these species fit. Hopefully that answers that question.
Yeah, I think it does. So I think that's certainly an interesting point. We are now over the top of the hour here. So it looks like we've run up to about the end of our time for the webinar. So stand by as we pull up One last slide. And that's about it. So thanks everybody for joining us today. And thank you, especially Jesse. It's been a pleasure to work with you on it.
Thank you very much, David. I appreciate it.
Sure thing. Have a good afternoon, everybody.